name of Jesus, hallelujah. Jesus, keep me near the cross.
Oh,
Bye.
call up on the name of the Lord. Just reflect that he's your only possession this morning. The house, the land, the cars, we cannot leave this world with it. But when we leave this world, we can truly take over Jesus with us this morning. Oh, bless the name of
Jesus. My reason for living.
My greatest possession.
Glorify your name this morning. You're everything, Lord. We lift up our lives unto you, Jesus. Knowing that you are our source, mighty God. Mighty God, many of us should have been dead and gone, but Jesus, our reason for living, we give you thanks this morning. Thank you for waking us up this morning, Lord Jesus. Thank you for bringing us together one more Sunday morning to worship and adore your matchless name. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you, Lord. What can we render this morning for all your benefits towards us? Oh God, but to give you thanks. We thank you, Heavenly Father. Father, we present this day worship before you, Lord God. Father, may our praises be acceptable unto you this morning. Father God, we look to you. In this day's worship and charge, bless each and everything that should be said and done this morning. Mighty God, as we humble before you, oh God, our provider, our way maker, oh Jesus, lead and direct this morning, oh God. We give you the honor, the glory. You are worthy. You are the King of all King, mighty God. You are our only possession, Lord Jesus. Nothing is valuable, oh God, like you, Jesus. You're all in all. We look to you, Lord. We look to you, Father God. Cover us this morning. Continue to guide and to protect your people, Lord Jesus. Have your own way this morning, mighty God. Bless the man servant today, Lord, as he shall bring forth the word, Lord Jesus. Have your own way, Jesus. Have your own way, Father God. Move through these benches this morning. Move through these chairs this morning, God. Touch each and every one individually. Touch us collectively, Lord God. And may your spirit have its own force in our life, Lord God. Have thine own way as we continue to look to you, Father God. Bless and keep us now, we pray. As we commit everything into your hands, we say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for who you are. Oh, forgiving Father, mighty God, everlasting Father, the King of all kings, have your way this morning, Jesus. We love you, oh, blessed Father. We love you, Lord Jesus, because you first love us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
God. Shall we praise the name of Jesus? All glory to God. Hallelujah to God. Hallelujah. You can't tell but make a shout when you sing about him this morning. For he is our greatest possession this morning. Some of us don't have much, but when we have Jesus, oh glory to God. The writer said, silver and gold have I none. Oh bless the name of Jesus. Oh bless the name of Jesus. Silver and gold I have none. But the word of God said, and such as I have, I'll give to you. And what it is? Jesus. In the name of Jesus, rise up. Come on, church of God. You have Jesus this morning. It's more than enough to worship him. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. It's more than the food on your table this morning. Because if you have Jesus, you have food. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Do you love him this morning? I love to sing about the goodness of Jesus this morning. I can truly say, he is my everything. He is my only possession. Some of us can claim our children. Some of us can claim our houses, our wives, our husband. But this morning, when you can truly say, Jesus, you are my reason for living. Why you think a lot of people are committing suicide? They have no reason for living. But when we have Jesus, we have reason. Oh, glory to God. When we have Jesus, we have reason to live. The writer said, because he lives, I can face. Doesn't matter what it looks like. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Because he lives, our fears are gone. And hear what the songwriter said. Jesus this morning. Just lift your hands in the sanctuary and give him a wave offering, for we love him this morning. The writer said, with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind this morning. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. Stay in sweet fellowship with the Lord this morning. I'm presenting to you this morning the man of God, and Russell, as they come forward to bring the word of God.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praises of our King rise among us. Let it rise. Lift him up, lift him up.
people of God.
Bless the name of Jesus.
People of God. We are not in a religious service. We are here to serve God. We are here to make a joyful noise unto the Lord. We are here to dance in the presence of an holy and righteous God. Come on, it's okay. It's okay. Have fun in the Lord. Hallelujah. You're not restricted. Just get up and just have fun. When you come to the house of God, you just need to just put everything in it. Amen. And just put it all and have a good time.
Yeah.
Are we going to sing this song again? Are we going to just have a ball in the house of God? We're going to just worship God. We're just going to dance in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Because God created dance for his own purpose.
Yeah.
Amen. So that we can dance and sing and just have a good time. So let's do that right now. Let's go. Come on, let's get some.
Let the glory of the Lord rise among us. Let the praising of our King rise among us. Let it rise.
God. You may be seated if you can in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. We are not religious people. We are the children of the Most High God. We are royal priesthood. We are a holy nation. And when we come in the presence of our King, hallelujah, we will dance like David danced. Hallelujah. We're going to have fun in the Lord. Hallelujah. When we come to the house of God, God wants us to just express ourselves before Him in whatever way, amen, you can. So we are here to give God praise and glory and honor. And I thank God for everyone in this house today. It is the Lord's day. It's a powerful day. It's another day. Amen. That God is here to bless us. Amen. Do you come with the blessing? If you come with the blessing, then you come with the blessing, and surely you shall receive a blessing. Hallelujah. If you come empty today, I don't want you to leave empty. I want the power of God and the Spirit of God to fill you up. Amen. So when you leave this place, you won't leave here the same way you came in, but you'll leave here feeling refreshed, rejuvenated with life. Oh, hallelujah. We want to make sure that we are always in a place of happiness and glory. Amen. To our King. Too often, we as people of God, we seem so depressed, so bored. I always wonder what unsaved think about us. That you're supposed to have the joy of the Lord, and they look at you and you look so sad and grumpy. Not approachable. You scared them off because of the facial expression. And we're supposed to have joy of the Lord. And the Lord says, what on the inside will show on the outside. So if there's joy within, we're going to see joy. Hallelujah. When you walk among the world, in the world, among your peers at work, in schools, and wherever you are, there's a certain amount of joy. It has become contagious because they want what you have. But today, they don't seem to want what we have because we have nothing showing or nothing given. We are just walking. We are just moving because we have life in us. The key of the world is heating up and taking over our lives that we don't have no joy. But I hope you're not just having joy in the house, but wherever you go, make sure the joy of the Lord is your strength. In your workplace, it doesn't matter what comes in your way, make sure the joy of God in you is resonating more than the situation that you're in. I greet you all and I thank God for every one of you in this house today. Hallelujah. This is the house of God. This is the place we come to glorify our King. And God loves us and give us the opportunity to be here. And I don't take it lightly because, you know, many did not make it seconds ago. And we are here. So every time we let's use it to bring honor unto God. I thank God for our sister church here today. I don't know, but I'm believing that God's going to bless us, that we'll be able to impact the nations and to see God do some great work out there in Siksika and wherever in the nation that they take us. I believe God has personally brought forth a relationship with us that we can go out and we can bless God's people. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. I'm looking forward for the camp meeting coming up this week. Amen. They start Wednesday night. I'll be going out Wednesday night. And also Saturday, I'll be doing an ordination out there on Saturday. Sister Pearl will be doing the moderating Saturday night. On Monday night, I'll be the one that will go out and close out the camp meeting. But I purpose to be there for those 3 nights. So if anyone want to join us, or that are going, And just for safety reason, in the sense that you don't get lost, because, you know, there is not such address that, you know, if you can just link up with the people that are going, that we can go together. Yes. Amen. So that we, nobody get lost, because I don't know where to find you if you get lost out there. Amen. So, amen. If we can just try to get together, and then we can go for whatever night you're thinking that you'd like to be there, one of those three nights, just let us know. And we can just drive together. We can meet somewhere, and then we can go in together. And I'm looking forward to a big event that we're looking forward to, that we're planning. It's Kids Day in Siksika. And Kids Day is just like we have in Jamaica, where we just look after the children. You know, we're going to cook for them. We're going to allow them. We're just going to do things that, you know, whatever it is to bring blessing to their hearts. Yes. Amen. Whatever God will help us to do for them, so that the children in Siksika can know that we love them. Amen. That there's a purpose. Amen. That there's other people out there that care about them and what's going on in their lives. So we'll go out there and we're going to impact that nation. And if God said we're going to go to another place, at some point we will go. But right now our focus is in Siksika, and we're going to do all we can out there. Amen. To impact that nation. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. It is Lord's Supper Day, and the Bible says, as often as we do this, we do show the Lord's death until he come. Actually, what it really means is that you remember what he did. Amen. So every time you raise the cup to drink and you eat that bread, you remember that his blood was shed on Calvary and his body was broken to give us life. And that's why it's important that we don't take it lightly when we're doing it. We need to know why we are doing it, understand the significance of it. And that's why the Bible said, if we do it unworthily, you know, we become sickly and weak and even fall asleep. It doesn't mean that you're dead. It just means that you have no life in you. Amen. So, but as we partake of it, let's prepare our hearts. You know, it doesn't mean you need to do it, take one here. God's a God of, it's very forgiving. You know, the thing about it, if you sin yesterday and you just say, Lord, forgive me, it is finished. Yes, it is done. Amen. So don't think that you have to go lay in the presence of God for 3, 5, 6 days, hours and hours, and labor and believing that, you know, for him to hear you. As quick as you sin, you see it. As quick as it comes out of your mouth, God, forgive me, he does it. Yes. So that's how easy it is. So don't think that you need to wait one here. I got to miss this. I got to wait till next month. No, just said, God, forgive me. I have sinned. And he says, faithful and just to forgive. That's the God that we serve. Amen. He's not like us, right? We said we forgive, but then we linger with this little part in the back. But I will not forget. But either you forgive or you don't. If you forgive, you forget. That's right. You pick up the pieces, you move on. But not because we forgive you. Don't use that liberty to keep doing it. Because sometimes we know that if we bring the rose, it'll kind of smooth things down, and you go back doing the same thing tomorrow and expect the rose to work again. No, you might have to bring something else. And after a while, you realize that you can't. You have nothing more to bring. You run out of things to bring. And all of a sudden, it means nothing. So let us live our lives, amen, as best as we can. As the word of God says, if it is possible, live peaceably with all men, that including your spouse and children and everyone. Amen. Hallelujah. This is the word of God. We live by the word. We die by the word. This is the word of God. We live by the word. We die by the word. This is the word of God. We live by the word. We die by the word. You may be seated in the house of the true and living God. Hallelujah. I thank God that we have completed over the last months, looking at the fruit of the Spirit, the works of the flesh, and how it affects us. And we realize when we accomplish that task, it is a task to be able to live and walk by the Spirit. And it's even a more task to try to avoid the 17 works of the flesh. In other words, to kill one so that the others can grow. Amen. And there was a parable in the Bible where Jesus, the question was asked, when the seeds were sown, the man that planted the seed, he planted good seed. But by the next day, guess what? There was all weed in it. And the servant went to the master and said, "Master, what should we do? Should we just kill these weeds?" He said, "But if you kill those weeds, it will kill the wheat." But this is different, you see, because when you kill the flesh, you're not plucking up anything. You're killing it so that something else will grow. So there's a difference. So let us think that we can keep looking after the works of the flesh because we don't want to kill it. We need to kill it so that the fruit of the Spirit will grow. In other words, we need room. We need land room. So that the flesh die and there'll be room for the Spirit man to manifest. Because the flesh man will cover and keep down the Spirit man. But if we can kill it, then guess what? The Spirit man will bloom and blossom. And you will have joy, peace, long suffering. You'll have all that requires of us. Guess what? Then we will be like Jesus. We all say we sing the song, "Want to be like Jesus," don't we? Then we would be like him. So I'm really hoping that this month of going through this teaching has helped you. And if you missed it, you can go to the YouTube channel and they're there. And you can always watch it. That's one good thing about what God has done through media, is that we can always go back. You can't put me on pause, but you can put the media in pause. And you can watch and you can go do what you're doing and you can come back. So you can make it work for you. Yes. Amen. You can't put a stop button on me. When I gotta go, I gotta go. When I gotta speak, I do what I have to. But you have that opportunity at home to go back and look at it. So what I want to talk to you about today, I want to look at someone in the Old Testament, but he's in the Old Testament, but in the New Testament, they brought him forward and they spoke about him in the New Testament as well. Because there's this, what happened in the Old Testament is still happening today. So it's not done away with. It is still happening to us today in Christendom in the New Testament church. So I want us to turn our Bibles to Numbers 22. And in my heart, I want to read from verse 1 to verse 35. It's long, but I really want to labor at 32 and 35. But in order for us to get the fullness of it, can we read through 35 verses? Amen. Let's just read through this so we can get the fullness of what we're trying to say here. Amen? Can we stand and let's just read together? I'm going to read through this, and I want you to get, it's very important that we get it. Amen. Praise God. "And the children of Israel set forward
and pitched the plains of Moab and beside Jordan by Jericho. and the sons of Zipporah.
So all that Israel had done to the Amorites,
and Moab was so afraid of the people because they were many, and Moab was distressed because of the children of Israel. And Moab said unto the elders of Midian, thou shalt be something new to all that is around us, as thou shalt be of the grass of the field. And Moab, the son of Zipporah, was king of the Moabites at that time. He sent his messengers to the river unto Balaam, the son of Beor, which is by the river of the land of children of Israel, to call him, saying, Behold, there is people come out from Egypt. Behold, they cover the face of the earth, and they cry over against me. Come now, therefore, I pray thee, curse me this people, for they are too mighty for me. Peradventure I shall prevail, that he may smite them, and that I may drive them out of the land. For I know that he whom thou hast cursed is cursed. And he whom thou hast cursed is cursed. And the elders of Moab, and the elders of Midian, departed with the lords of the nation in their land. And they came unto Balaam, and spake unto him the words of Balaam. And he said unto them, Lodge here this night, and I will bring you word again, as the Lord shall speak unto me, and the princes of Moab walk with me. And the Lord came unto Balaam, and said, What men are these with thee? And Balaam said unto God, Balak the son of Zippor, king of Moab, has said unto me, saying, Behold, here is people come out of Egypt, which cover the face of the earth. Come now, curse him, peradventure I shall be able to overcome them and drive them out. And God said unto Balaam, Thou shalt not hold with them, thou shalt not curse the people, for they are blessed. And Balaam rose up in the morning and said unto the prince of Balaam, Get thee into your land, for the Lord refused to give thee the people who will. And the princes of Moab rose up, and they went unto Balak, and said, Balaam refuses to come with us. And Balak said, Get thee
to the princes of
Moab. And they came to Balak, and said to him, Thus say Balak, the son of Zippor, Let nothing I pray thee any of you from coming unto me, for I have promoted thee unto very great honor. And I will do whatsoever thou sayest unto me. Come therefore, I pray thee, curse me this people. And Balaam answered and said unto the servants of Balak, If Balak would give me his house full of silver and gold, I cannot go beyond the word of the Lord my God, to do less or more. Now therefore, I pray you, tarry also here this night, that I may know what the Lord will say unto me more. And God came unto Balaam at night, and said unto him, If the man come to call thee, rise up and go with him. But yet the word which I shall say unto thee, thou shalt do. And Balaam rose up in the morning, and saddled his ass, and went to the prince of Moab. And God's anger was kindled because he went. And the angel of the Lord stood in the way of what I had said against him. Now he was riding on my ass, and his two servants were with him. And the ass saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way,
and his sword drawn in his hands. And the ass turned aside out of the way, and went into the field, and Balaam smote the ass to turn him into the way.
But the angel of the Lord stood in a path of the angel, a wall being on this side, and a wall on that side. And when the man's ass saw the angel of the Lord,
he thrust himself on the wall,
crushed the Balaam's foot against the wall, and he smote her again. And the angel of the Lord went further and stood in a narrow place, where there was no way to turn
either to the right or to the left.
And when the man's ass saw the angel of the Lord, he fell down on the Balaam, and Balaam's anger was kindled, and he smote the ass
And the Lord will open the mouth of the ass. And she said unto Balaam, What have I done unto thee, that thou hast smitten me these three times?
And Balaam said unto the ass, Because thou hast mocked me, I would there were a sword in my hand, for now would I kill thee.
And the ass said unto Balaam, A man I have asked.
Upon she saw that written, Since I was like unto this day, was I ever wanted to do so unto thee?
And he said, Nay.
Then the Lord opened the eyes of Balaam, and saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and his sword drawn in his hands. And he bowed down his head, and fell flat on his face. And the angel of the Lord said unto him, Wherefore hast thou smitten thy ass three times? Behold, I went out to withstand thee, because the grave is perverse before me. And thou saw me, and turned from me these three times. Unless she have turned from me, surely thou also hast saved thee, and saved her alive. And Balaam said unto the angel of the Lord, I have sinned, for I knew not that thou stoodest in the way against me. Now therefore, if it displease thee, I will give back the aid. And the angel of the Lord said unto Balaam, Go with the man, but only the word that I shall speak unto thee, thou shalt speak. So Balaam went with the prince of Balak.
Praise God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. So God wills, God way. God will, God way. When we look at the story here today and we look at what happened here. How is it today? I'm going to just ask a few questions before I get the point. How is it today that the world is not fearful of us? And back then, the world was afraid of Israel because they see them as a powerful people. But today, they're not scared of us. And we are spiritual Israel. The world look at us as nothing. But back then, they look at us as powerful people. They were afraid of the Israelites. Why? Because they heard what God was doing through them and with them. They left Egypt and they were heading towards the promised land. And today we are heading towards the promised land just as they were. And the world was afraid of them because the power of God that was in them to conquer. Every nation that would come against them, God would allow them to conquer them. They were equipped with the power of God to conquer. God allowed them to conquer. Today, what are we as people of God? What are we conquering? We are not afraid of the world. You see the reverse?
That's right.
At one point they were afraid of us.
Yes.
Now we are afraid of them.
Yes.
Because now we think they have more power than us. While we have more power than them. Because we have Jesus that will fight for us. And what is happening, you can see also here that they were so afraid of them that they wanted to curse them. And they find somebody who they think has the power to curse. They think this man has the power to curse Israel. Today, they think they have the power to curse us. But they have no power to curse us. Because in Genesis, the Bible says to Abraham that whom is I blessed is blessed and whom I have cursed is cursed. So the only person who has power to curse and to bless is God himself.
Right.
So as people of God, nobody can curse you.
That's right.
many times we're walking and we're believing what the false prophets are saying about even generational curse. When you're in Christ, nobody can curse you because Christ is blessing you, and what old things are passed away and all things become new. There is no generational curse in the New Testament church. So you don't need to stand in a line because nobody can curse you when God bless you.
That's right.
There's a lot to glean from here. So much. But when we look at it, we realize that God went and spoke to Balaam and said, listen, these people, they're mine. You haven't got no power over them to curse them. But you see, there was something happening with Balaam that Balak knew about. Because he was cursing and putting curse on people. So he thought that he could do that to God's people. And many of us want to go to some people, try to curse some people, go to Obi Man, think you can hurt God's people. You cannot hurt God's people. If God bless you, nobody can curse you. We are the one who curse ourselves. Because we're not walking in the will of Christ. In the righteousness of Christ. Hallelujah. So here it is. Balaam, God says, you know what? These are my people. I don't want you to go and curse them. But Balak sent somebody out and bring some presents. And when he looked at the presents, he said, guess what? He probably looked at the money and figured, well, oh, this is not worth it. I'm not going to do this job for that. So he sent them back and said, you know what? I'm not going. But he knew the will of God that he should not go. Because God already appeared to him and said, these are my people. They are blessed. But the second time, the Bible says he went back and it was more honorable. The word honorable means it was more than what he brought the first time. And you see how the devil works? The first time he figured it wasn't enough, so he sent back with more.
That's right.
So guess what? When he went back the second time and Balaam looked and see that, man, this is looking good.
Yes.
Because remember he said, even if he give me my house, his house full of gold, I won't go. But whatever he brought was more enticing, so he had to think about it. So guess what he did? He asked the man to stay overnight. So that I can see what God says. You already know what God says.
That's right.
How many of us that God has given a commandment?
Yes.
And said, do this.
Yes.
Go do this.
Yes.
And you're going back and say, God, I'm still waiting. And God already spoken over your lives and said, this is what you should be doing. And you're sitting there waiting. God's not going to change his mind.
That's right.
So he asked the man to stay over.
That's right.
To see if God changes his mind.
Yeah, it looked good.
Because why? He started contemplating about what he saw.
Yeah, it looked good.
It looks good. And he's trying to move the hands of God and change God's mind. Many of us want to change God's mind.
Yes, sir.
You know it's wrong.
That's right.
But God will understand. He's not going to understand.
That's right.
Because he already said no.
That's right. Amen.
So here it is. God said, okay, you want to go? You go. So the Bible says he left them up to erupt a bit minds.
Yes, that's right.
So guess what? He's going, but he's not having God with him.
That's right.
That reminds us of many preachers today.
That's right.
We're in the pulpit, but God is not there with us.
That's right.
Because he didn't send you anywhere.
That's right.
You're in your home.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So Balaam was going forward to do as God has instructed him, but he was going with the wrong motives.
That's right.
So you see, he was going But he was going with the wrong motive because he was going with riches.
That's right.
Yeah. It's wholehearted obedience turned into half-hearted greed for wealth.
That's right.
And prestige.
That's right.
Many of us, as God called us and sent us out, and we walked out and stepped out in faith. But we change our focus and our motive become wrong when we see what we can gain in the process. So you started out good, but the motives change. Because first you love the souls of men, but guess what? In the interim, you don't care so much about the souls no more. You start caring about the finance and what you can get.
Yes.
Come on.
Glory to God.
Amen.
It's not about the souls of man no more. You start looking at the financial gain.
Yes.
That you can get from it. So the motives for going out and preaching the gospel, it is not for the souls of men. It's for what you can put in your pocket. It's what you think you can get from the people. And you go out and you lie to get it. Because you think you can brainwash the people. Because you might have some gifting. And the people might already know that you have some gifting. And because you have some gifting, you think, guess what? We better act because God is with them. Or God is with him. And you do everything because you believe that God is with him. But the motive has been shifted. And become greed for wealth and prestige.
Yeah.
It's covetousness blind his eyes. The angels of the Lord who was blocking the path of his travel,
yes,
he could not see.
He couldn't see.
He become blindfolded,
yes,
because of his greed and covetousness.
Yes. Blind him. Amen.
So his focus shifted.
Yes.
And today, that's what's happening with us. We started out, and God is going to bless us. And you know God's going to bless you. But as soon as God starts blessing you, your motives change, and you turn from God, and you start doing your own thing. You start building your own house.
That's right.
It's not God's house anymore. You don't want his direction no more, because you believe that now it's looking good. I know how to attain it.
Yes, sir.
That's right. Lord.
His eyes were focused on the hope for riches and the hope not to fulfill his mission no more. So he wasn't going to fulfill his mission. Now he was going for the money.
That's right.
I know many of us go to our jobs not because we like the job.
The money.
Trust me. It's a little bit different, right?
Yeah.
But he went not because of the soul anymore.
That's right.
He went because he saw what the gain could be.
Yes.
So the motive has been shifted from bringing glory to God,
yes,
to bringing glory to himself.
That's right.
You see, we have to be careful what we are doing as people of God.
Right.
When God is blessing us.
Yes.
You got to remember where the blessings come from. You got to remember who is the blesser. You got to remember that you can't bless nobody. You cannot curse nobody. The only person can bless and curse is God himself. And all glory must be to God. Oh, hallelujah. Because he says he will not share his glory with another.
That's right. Glory to God.
All of a sudden it was God's church, but now you got a new property in the big land. It is now my church. Because what he said he will do, he will do. He says he's going to bless you, and he's going to bless you. But he says when he blesses you, don't forget him.
Don't forget him.
But God blesses people and don't forget him.
Yes.
Because it's now me, myself, and I. It is mine.
Yes.
And the Bible says the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, and the world, and they that dwell in. Yes. So even you is owned by God.
Yes.
So you own nothing, not even your own self.
That's right.
But the devil move your focus.
Yes.
From the blesser,
yes,
and put it on you.
Yes.
So guess what? The glory goes to the devil instead of goes to the right place, to God, because the motive has been shifted.
Yes.
And we do it in our lives, don't we?
Yes.
Hallelujah. His eyes became blinded.
Yes.
Because his focus has been shifted. That the angels of God stood before him.
Yes.
That the donkey.
Yes. That's right. Yes. God has to love the donkey.
Think about it for a moment.
Right.
The prophet of God.
Yes, that's right.
His eyes are blinded to the things of God.
Man of God. Amen.
It's a talk about the man of God.
Yes.
His eyes become blind. Because of his greed.
That's right.
That he lose focus, that the donkey,
yes,
eyes was still,
yes,
in the right place.
Yes, Lord.
And the man of God, the prophet of God,
yes,
that the donkey have to look at the man and say, guess what, man?
Yes.
How long I have been your master?
Amen.
You have been my master for a long time.
Yes.
Did I ever disobey you?
That's right. That's right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
The man's eyes moved off course.
Yes.
Off God.
Yes.
Because riches,
yes,
was in his path.
Yes.
He moved God away from him.
Amen.
But the donkey,
yes,
still was in focus.
That's right. Still obedient.
Was still in focus.
Amen.
That he could have seen the angel of God stood before him.
Yes.
Sometimes God have to use some donkey,
yes,
to turn some people,
yes,
that think they're so smart.
Yes.
Yes. Rise them up.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
God will have to raise up some donkeys, yes, in these ministries.
Yes. Yes.
When they think they have no ability.
That's right. That's right.
God will have to raise them up. Why? Because their eyes are still focused.
Yes.
You might look at them in a dummy, but God has a plan for them.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And when you become so eloquent,
yes,
that you not even listen for what God is saying, we find some people that are still dear. They look like donkeys, but they're still focusing. And God will use the donkey to speak to the people of God to change.
Yes.
Right among us.
Amen, amen, amen.
We're looking at some people and we think they don't value anything.
That's right.
But their eyes are focused.
That's right.
They're in prayer.
That's right.
They're talking to God daily.
That's right.
And even on your behalf.
That's right.
Because they recognize that you have lost focus.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Right.
It is not about the souls of man no more. It's not about God no more. It's about what you can gain from God's people.
Yes. Yes.
Hey.
Hey, Lord. Yes, Jesus.
Jesus.
Balaam ceased to reside in prayer and conscious awareness of God's presence. He lose the consciousness of the presence of God. The Bible says in his presence there is fullness of joy. When you're in the presence of God, you will know.
Yes.
Because there is a spirit that dwells in you. There's a certain amount of atmospheric presence,
yes,
that will keep you, and you will know that God is with you. It doesn't matter what you're going through. You know that God is with you because you can feel his presence ever near you.
Yes, yes. Glory to God.
His focus shift, and he moved from the presence of God and into the presence of the devil, focusing on the things that you can gain. The thing that will only last for a moment. And the Bible says, what does it profit a man for you to gain the whole world and lose your whole soul? Hallelujah, church.
Praise the Lord.
We need to get that place that we stay focused. Get back in line. Don't let God have to use a donkey.
Yes.
And he said, if we don't want to praise him, we'll raise up stones too.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
However, there are three times God was there narrowing his way. Sometimes God is there resisting you. When you're trying to go, he's there resisting you. He's trying to, he's making things so hard for you. But you still keep pressing. God is saying, that's not the way to go. And he's there doing everything to stop you from going there. But guess what? Your eyes are blinded.
Yes.
You can't see. You can't feel the present no more. And then you say you're not hearing from God. Why? Because something else has taken over that place.
That's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
Many of us said, oh, I used to hear from God, but I'm not hearing no more. What it is that take over your life, that move you from where you were so that you could hear the voice of God? There must be a shift that happened in your life. You got to check your life so that you can make the necessary adjustment, so you can get back in line, so you can get back to the place that you can hear. Like the Bible says, you got to go back to your first love.
Yes, sir.
So you can hear him again.
Yes, sir.
You can love him again.
Yes.
His voice.
Yes.
Will make the difference.
Yeah.
What it is that you're going through. God loves you enough that even when you persist doing things ignorantly or out of his will, he still loves you enough to try to bring you back in line.
Yeah.
He still want to bring you back in line.
Amen.
He will derail us.
That's right.
Just as he did with Balaam. Talking donkey. I can imagine what a shocker. You have this donkey for all his years. All of a sudden, the donkey can't talk.
Yes.
I wonder how fast was he running. Come on, church. Your donkey that's been faithful for years.
Yes.
Turn around talking to you.
Mm-hmm.
Man, I would be moving.
Right now, it's
scary.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
God will put up things in a way to stop us from going the wrong way. But our eyes must be open.
Yes.
So that we can see where we are going. To say when God is directing you, that if he said turn here, you turn here. If he said go there, you go there. The Bible says a good man steps, they're ordered by God.
Yeah.
If your eyes are blinded, how can you see where you're going?
That's right.
Hallelujah. And that's why he said the blind cannot lead the blind. And many of us in the pulpit today, our mind has become so convoluted in the things of the world that we become blind and we are leading God's people astray.
Amen.
We're leading them down to the pit. But the Bible says, woe be unto those that lead my children astray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God had to use the talking donkey to get his attention. What will God use to get your attention? Let's rephrase it to say, what is God using even right now to get your attention? You got to know. You got to know what you're going through. It's not everything that happened in your life is the devil. Because this is what's going on here. This is not the devil.
No.
This is God giving him a wake-up call.
That's right. That's right.
What it is that God has to put in your life to wake you up.
Amen.
So that you can get back in line with him.
Amen.
So you can get back on track with him.
Amen. Hallelujah. Jesus. Thank you.
Don't expect him to use your cat or your goats. He can use your kids. He can use your workers. He can use anything.
Yes.
Or anybody.
Right.
To let you know that you're moving.
Yes.
In the wrong way. Yes. Any ever somebody said, I thought you were Christian.
Mm-hmm.
That could be a wake up call.
Yes.
Big time.
Glory.
I heard that many times. People asking me, I thought you were a Christian. Why? Because what you're doing,
yes.
It doesn't line up
right.
with being a Christian. It's a wake up call.
Yes.
You might not have the talking donkey, but there'll be somebody beside you that said, what are you doing, man? What are you doing, woman? What are you doing, girl? What are you doing, boy? Don't you realize you said you're a man of God? But your life doesn't look like it. God wants us to get back in right standing, in right fellowship with him.
Amen.
So we can learn some things from God's prophet Balaam, don't we?
Amen.
God allow us to do what we want to do. Do you understand that? God spoke to him and said, don't go. But he tried everything possible to disobey God. Tried to change God's mind so that God would say yes. Eventually God said, okay, go. But when you go, whatever I say,
yes.
Thou shalt speak. You're greedy and you want this, but speak as an earth-laugh God.
Yes.
Don't speak what you feel like. So every time they try to curse Israel, it is a blessing.
That's right.
Think about it for a moment, people of God. When anybody trying to curse you,
yes.
God will turn it around to be a blessing, because it is a blesser that meant evil, but God turned it around for your own good.
That's right.
Yes,
praise
Lord.
God. Praise God.
More blessed, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
They want to curse you.
Yes.
But every time they open your mouth, it's a blessing.
That's right. Lord.
Oh, hallelujah.
Lord.
When you're in line with God,
amen.
The enemy want to destroy you.
Yes.
But instead of they hate you, they got to love you.
That's right. Yes, Lord.
Oh, hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Every time Balaam would speak,
yes.
Instead of a curse would come out of his mouth, it was a blessing. More blessing. I will multiply thee. I will give you this. I will make you prosperous.
Yes. More blessing. Amen.
When you're in the will of God and God has blessed you and man wants to curse you, they cannot curse what God has blessed. Oh, hallelujah. So don't walk around feeling defeated. Walk around knowing that you are blessed of God and no man can curse you. You are the one that can curse yourself by walking out of the will of God.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
You're going to walk like people that know that you are blessed.
That's right.
When you get into the workplace, people should know that you're blessed.
That's right.
You walk in the mall, they should know that you're blessed. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
God bless you.
Amen.
How are you doing today?
Amen.
Because what's on the inside is manifesting on the outside.
That's right.
Hallelujah.
Praise
glory
Lord.
To God.
Amen.
And the devil will say, I don't want no mourning from you, but you already did it. Whether you want or not, it's already gone.
Yes.
You cannot take it back. I already said it. It is finished. It is done. Whether you receive it or not, it is done.
Praise God.
You got to walk around. Hallelujah. Knowing that you are blessed. When they want to curse you, you got to know that you are blessed. No devil can touch you when God says, I build a fence around you. Oh, hallelujah. When God said, I protect your going and your coming, no man, no devil can curse you.
Amen.
Because you see, Balak missed it.
Yes.
He did not understand or read the Torah. Mm-hmm. Because the Torah make it plain in Genesis that God is the one that will bless you. He said to Abraham, I will move you from among your kindred.
Amen.
And I will put you in a place.
Yes.
And I will bless you.
Yes.
And I'll bless your children.
Amen.
So we are of Abraham's seed.
Amen.
And the blessings of God is on us, and nobody can curse us. Man of God, nobody can curse you.
That's right.
Woman of God, nobody can curse you. Little girls, yeah, woman of God, nobody can
curse
you. Hallelujah.
Lord.
They want to, but they missed it. They don't understand it.
Right.
Oh, hallelujah. They gone to the Holy Land, think they can affect your lives.
Yes.
They gone to the palm readers, think they can affect your lives. They think they can go wherever they're going, think they can affect your lives. But nobody can affect your life because you're covered under the blood of Jesus Christ. He will protect you. You're going, you're coming. He's going to protect you. He's responsible for you. And nobody can kill you unless God say, do it. God has to give the permission. But God allow him to do it. Why? That's what is called the permissive will of God. He tell you no. He said, don't go. Don't do this. But you think it will be so much of a fun that I'm going to go. And you go and something happens. And then you said, if I had known. It's not if I had known. You already know. You made a choice to go. Because God said, don't go. But you tried to twist his arm in every area of your life. God said, don't marry her. Don't marry him. You still do it. And then you have a horrible life. And guess what? Try to blame God for it. Oh, glory to God. It means that we will sometimes allow, God will allow us to do things that we insist on doing. Even when what he wants directly oppose his will. So what God wants from us directly, even though it opposed the will of God for your life, he will still allow you to do it because he's an holy God. He's a righteous God. He will tell you. But he is not a slave driver. He will tell you and you can make your choice. It is wrong for you, but you want to make your choice. The decision is ultimately up to you.
That's right.
It's your decision. Hallelujah. Listen what God says in the New Testament church. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 15 and 16. Which are forsaken the right way and are gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who love the wages of unrighteousness. Come on. God said, don't do it. 2 Peter 2, verse 15 and 16. God said, don't do it. But Peter is reminding us in the New Testament church that today we are doing it. He said, which have forsaken the right way.
Yes.
And are gone what? Astray. Following what? the way of the son of who love the what?
Of unrighteousness.
So he went astray because of greed. Today, many of us leaders, we are gone astray after the substitute of Baal. Because what? We gone after unrighteous things. We move away from doing the right thing in the house of God, and we pervert the gospel of Jesus Christ. We make it a get-rich scheme. The way of Balaam. Hallelujah. What was rebuked for its iniquity? The dumb ass speaking with man's voice. Forbid the madness of the prophet. So God is speaking to us today, even now in the New Testament church, that we should not follow the way of Balaam. That's still happening today. Greed. Greed cannot get enough. You fleece God people. You take what they don't have. There are people in your house hungry, and you're having $10 million in the bank, buying millions of dollar airplane, and there are people still in your congregation that cannot send your kids to school. How do you justify that in the presence of an holy God? You're God after Baal and righteousness. Because the holy God would not allow that to happen. He will do the right thing for his people. God want to bless his people. Yes. Hallelujah. Not curse them. The house of God sometimes become a curse instead of a blessing. Because of the way we operate in it. Because of the way we operate in the house of God. The world is not fearful of us. And I'm not talking about the fear. I'm talking about the fear of love that they would want to be among us. I'm not talking about the fear that it's afraid of. I'm talking about the world should have fear that they want to be a part of us. Just as always the fear of God is in us that we want to love God. The world should want to be a part of us. But instead, they're afraid of us. I want nothing to do with us. Many today say, many would say today, they only want our money. They don't care about us. That's what the house of God become. That's not what it's for. Is it for a place to come and to refresh in the word and the knowledge of God so you can live to fight another day? Hallelujah. Listen to what it said in Romans chapter 8, verse 33 to 34. Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justified. Who is he that condemned? It is Christ that died. Yea, rather, that it is risen again. Who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Today, they're still trying to destroy us. They're still trying to put curse on us. They're still trying to say negative thing about us. But only God can condemn us. Amen. If we live the way we are to live. Balak went to curse Israel. Many today want to curse God's elect.
That's right.
But it will not affect you if you are within the will of God. Every time they open their mouth to say something against you, it turns into a blessing.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Every time they think they have one in you, it turns into a blessing. Why? Because we are elect of God. Jesus Christ is now our great high priest. He's the one that looking over us. Every dart that will throw at us, the Bible says it will quench it. The fiery darts of the wicked, he will quench it. Hallelujah. Today, the darts are still throwing at us. We are spiritual Israel. And they're coming at us. They still want to curse us. But we got to make sure that we are in line with God. So that whenever they try to curse you, it will turn into a blessing. They want to curse you, but they got to bless you. They want to expect you to die, but you're living. Amen. Isn't it? Many would like to see us die. Many of us would like to see so many of us die. But God giving you life. More life. They expect you to wither up. But yet, you're just blossoming. You're just spreading like a green bay tree. Why? Because nobody can curse you when God bless you. Are you a blessed people? You not sure? Are you a blessed people? You don't sound like two blessed people. When you go to those the football stadium and those players are playing, it sounds like we're here and they're not blessed. So are we blessed people? Yeah. We sing this song. I know that I am blessed. When you know that you are blessed, the children of Israel weren't worried.
That's right.
Because they knew their God and the power of their God. Amen. Why? Because he parted the Red Sea so they could go through. So they know the power that exists. And when the world around is looking at these people, chosen people of God, and recognize the power that's in them and how they're annihilating everything around them, they become fearful. We should be spreading the gospel that all religion should become fearful. Religion should become fearful of the people of God. Revelation 2 verse 14. But I have a few things against thee, because thou art there then and held the doctrine of Baal, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. Revelation 2 verse 14. Today we still have that Baal doctrine. You hear it on the news and the television every day. The prosperity doctrine is still there today. Ireland's after one thing. You remember Balaam was hired hand, isn't he?
That's right.
Today we have those Ireland, and they don't care about you. They just care about what you can give them.
That's
all they care about. Put the money. Give me your money. And I don't care after that. Balaam was a hireling. Today we have many Ireland's in the pulpit. They don't care about you. All they want is what you can give them. And Satan still works just like that today. Just like these characters, Satan cannot directly curse God's people. So he finds another approach. He looks for the back door. We have to close those back doors in our life so that Satan cannot sneak in, because he's going to find another approach. And look for the back door that will be left open, like Israel. His wage and his wiggle his ways into the church today, and more often, even in the church, we have idolatry. People are worshiping their pastors.
That's right. It's true.
They think they're the God. What they say goes. The focus has been shifted from God to them. Sexual immoralities, all that's happening in the house of God. The prophet who rode a talking donkey wasn't so bad when you start reading about him, right? He sounded like he was a good man. He didn't sound like, at first when you met him, you might even like him. But it didn't take very long to show his true colors. That all he cares about was his money. His heart wasn't right with God. His ways was greed. His error was compromise. And his doctrine was betrayal and corruption. Does that sound like some churches today? The doctrines is compromise, betrayal, and corruption. Doesn't change. We got to be careful that we don't end up in a place like that. That the donkey have to talk. Close the back doors in your life. Listen for the doctrines and the word of God that you're listening to. Make sure it is pure. Make sure it's edifying. Make sure it's helping you. Make sure it's blessing your soul. If it's not blessing your soul, then you know that something is wrong. Stay within the presence of God. Wherever you go, take him with you. The songwriter said, take the name of Jesus with you, child of sorrow and a foe. It will joy and comfort gives you. Take it anywhere you go. Wherever you go in your life, make sure you're in the presence of God. In the workplace, stay in the presence. We got to impact our workplace so that people know who we are. Wherever we go, Christ must be the center of your lives. God bless you.
Hold me in your palm, your hands.
Hold me, Jesus.
Hold me in the palm of your hand.
Hold me, my King.
Hold me, Jesus. Hold me, mighty God. Hold me in the palm of your hand. Hold me in the palm.
By Jesus Christ, where we are safe and secure from all harms and from danger. I want to thank our pastor for the spoken words today. Hallelujah to God. Let us walk in confidence, knowing that we are blessed and highly favored of God. Put your hands together as we honor God today. Amen. What can we then say to these things?
God be for us.
What can we then say to these things?
If God be for us, who can be against us?
What can we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? We adjourn this session until 6 p.m. God bless you.